sage, rosemary, and thyme. Remember me to one who loves her. She answers so truly.
Let's get ready to rumble!
As the sage, rosemary, and thyme. Without no seams on either one, and she'll be a
green camouflage trimmed with gold and weighing in at 125.5 pounds. Ladies and gentlemen, here is the former British featherweight champion, former Commonwealth featherweight champion, and former European featherweight champion, and the reigning and defending IBF IBO featherweight champion of the world, Paul the Hunter.
You done a few miles up and down that beach, Paul?
You know, it's countless gold. Half a pee for every mile. We never had a penny. Be a millionaire, I tell you. I love boxing through, like, some family, you know, my uncle used to do it. But I never think I'd carry on and go professional and world champion and Olympic Games and world junior amateurs and all over the world. Flow all over the world, amateur, you know what I mean? Really do, and I have great respect for people who help me get there, amateur and professional. They have some brilliant amateur coaches, you know what I mean? First class.
Yeah. What British fighters at the moment, Paul, do you admire?
Mike Calbrook, really good fighter. Mike Khan, good fighter, just a bit to learn, but I'm going to get there.
Former world champion, what advice would you give to lads, you know, on the domestic scene, maybe who are at the stage where you was, you know, after the Colin McMillan fight and that, and you know, what does it take to move on to that world stage?
Just make sure you're 110% sure that you want to do it, and you're in right frame of mind, and you're earning, you want to do it. You're earning final, you've got to want to do it more than anybody else. If you don't want to do it, then don't do it. If you're going there self-doubt, then don't do it. You've got to be 110% you want to do it yourself and you'll be successful.
The step up from domestic level to world level, what was the big difference?
I just think it's getting the rounds behind you and knowing your confidence and your own ability you can get your rounds behind you and the ability that you can perform it. I mean, I had a good amateur pedigree. I've been all over the world, you know, fighting amateur. So I had the experience of fighting all different fighters. I think it was just the experience of you fighting, don't get carried away with what you're doing, you know what I mean?
Yeah, you put it on now, you've got to turn it on now, you've never done it. Keep that pressure there, Paul, you're doing it. Keep that fucking pressure there, Paul.
Yeah, he's been awfully confused tonight.
How do you think boxing views you and sees you now? How do you think, you know, the fans remember Paul, the Yorkshire Hunter?
Every time I walk in town, I'll go anywhere. I mean, all the fans are still there. The fans that I had are unbelievable. I had these on Sky TV. I mean, can thousands of turn out, you know what I mean? Surprised me, really. But I mean, Scarborough people have always been there for me, day one, you know what I mean? Good set of people.
You always had great support.
Definitely, I mean, even in New York, America. Fucking hell, there was more noise than Lex Lewis got now, the top of the bill, you know what I mean? I was like undercard for Lennox. And like, all you can able Scarborough people, Madison Square Garden, fucking how many thousands of miles away? New York, and they're really blasting it out, you know what I mean? All you can able Scarborough people, all the fighting Junior Jones over there. Local lad from round corner, you know what I mean? Brilliant.
Well, great support for Paul Ingle. They'll try to make themselves heard among this big arena.
I want you to obey my commands at all times, respect the bell at all times, and above all, protect yourself at all times. Touch them up, God bless.
It just made me feel so comfortable. It made me just feel like I was fighting in a sparring Scarberry, you know what I mean? And I won all in New York at Madison Square Gardens.
Some great featherweight fights at the Garden. Two of the Willie Pep Sandy Sadler battles were here. Salvador Sanchez's great fight with the then unknown Azuma Nelson, won in the last round by Sanchez, was here. Not to mention Kevin Kelly, Nassim Hamed. Here we go then. Ingle defending on away soil the IBF featherweight championship he won in thrilling fashion against Manuel Medina. Camouflage trunks of Ingle, the red of Poison Junior Jones, fighting in his hometown.
But in your boxing career, how would you know in your absolute prime of your career, how would you describe your mindset in them days, and you know how you thought about boxing and your tunnel vision to do what you did and you know be as successful as you did?
I just thought, you know, when I was boxing amateur, like, you know, boxing for England and all that, I just wanted to do really well and be successful. I had plans that I wanted, you know, to win the world title. I was my ultimate dream when I was amateur. I wanted to lift a world title professional. I never thought I'd do it. But, you know, as I progressed and went on as amateur, then did so well amateur and went professional, I thought, it's getting a bit closer now, I think, you know. But the team they had around me was really brilliant, you know what I mean? Good set of people.
How did you get into boxing, Paul, originally, when you was a kid?
My uncle used to box. And I used to go up to the amateur gym and watch him. I think I like doing that, but obviously I was only a little lad then, you know. I'd like to do that. Like, when I come that 8 year old, you're allowed to start the amateur club. And I went up there a couple of times to start with. And I had a couple of goes and had a couple of sparring sessions and went home nearly every night crying, saying, no, they paid me up there, I'm not going there again, I'm not doing boxing. But, you know, but I always went back and I just loved competing up there. It was brilliant, all the good set of lads, the amateur lads. It was just like a really good buzz when you were little, you know what I mean? Not like kept out of trouble, just going up there every night and enjoying myself. If I was allowed to fight now, I'd turn the clock back and go back. Mm. Even if I was at risk, I'd still fight professionally if I was allowed. I just love boxing, I love it outright, you know what I mean?
You did have a successful amateur career. It took you to the Olympics in 92, Barcelona Olympics. You did well. You ended up losing actually to the gold medal winner in, you know, in the, was it the second round?
The thing about it, he won the gold medal and they beat him by 1 point. But I mean, it was just the computer scoring. First time it had been used at the Olympics in 1992. And like 10 boxers went from Great Britain to the Olympic team. I think 8 got ripped off through the computer scoring. The scoring was absolutely ridiculous where they were scoring out there. I mean, 3 minutes of boxing. Scored the fight, I mean, the work rate that I used to go at. 13-12. I mean, come on, you know what I mean? And I threw that in about the first 30 seconds. But I mean, no, I think just the computer scoring ruined boxing. It's ruining boxing now, I think, I really do. Just, they can't compete with the punches and how the punches are thrown and the styles of boxers. You just can't compete with scoring them. But you'd be wearing like offensive vessel, touching vests and scoring punches, you know, it's ridiculous. Should go back to the old way, or let just the referee score it. He's the one who's saying, stop using your head, stop me punching low, you know what I mean? Just let the referee score it if one of you want. Shouldn't let computer scoring him do it. Stupid.
Was the frustrations of that then, is that in the end what made you decide that you was going to turn pro? Because I know you you did want to stay amateur, you loved the amateur game, didn't you? Like,
oh, I loved it first class. I mean, I loved boxing for England. And when they brought this computer scoring out, the same with the lads in there. Like I say, there was like 9-11 boxers that went to the Olympics from England. First time they had to qualify. 7 got ripped off with the computer scoring. The old lads felt the same, you know what I mean? And like, they'd used it in competitions before the Olympics. They got ripped off there, you just couldn't work the scoring out, however you do it. And how you adapted to the computer scoring, they were saying, you had to use straight punching, no body shots allowed. No body shots allowed, that's not the stuff you want boxing. They had defence in it, and body shots, head shots, hooks, uppercuts, right hands. And like they were saying, no, just straight punching. No body shots allowed, just straight. You know, we've got sword fences, all like that. And like, I think, you know, but like, apparently they were saying it's getting a lot better now, but looking at the last Olympics, I'm just thinking, same, the computer scoring is ridiculous.
Who was on that team at the time, on that English squad, the British squad that went to the Olympics?
Paul Livewire Lloyd, Robin Reid, Herbie Hyde, Julius Francis, Paul Lloyd, Paul Lyons, John Lyons, I wouldn't say it'd be 7-8 times, Robin Regan, Joe Kawasaki. Yeah, there's a good set of lads on it, all of them down there, you know what I mean? Mark Hemphill, Peter Richardson from Middlesbrough, good mate of mine, Peter, brilliant kid. I thought he'd won the world title, but bad things happened, you know what I mean? But he boxed a good few lads at Olympics.
How would you like to be remembered, Paul, as a boxer?
Just, I give 100%, exciting fighter, and a good sportsman, you know what I mean? Just to be good and did well at what I did, just train hard and get on with the job. I trained in Scarborough at the Alderman Cockrell Centre on Seymour Road, in Scarborough. That's Scarborough Amateur Boxing Club. First class boxing gym, that took me everywhere, that did. Got me to the Olympics, ABHL, everything. And when I fought for England, I went down to Crystal Palace at London. That's where we trained down there for England. But I mean, brilliant experience, good set of lads around us, first class.
You know, looking over there, Paul, them, you know, the hills there and all around the coast path.
Oh,
and
that light up there, we were smoking sprint up there. 10 or 15 times up there, you know you've done it, you know what I mean? Oh, your heart and lungs are out. First class that is. Good thing about Scarborough, variation, everything you want to do. If you want to do flat, you get flat. But if you want to do hills or anything, or you want to mix you, it's all here, fresh air here all the time. First class it is.
Turn pro, March 94, you know, taking us back to that first fight. Darren Noble in Wales, what do you remember that first night, you know, as a pro?
It felt good, getting to the head guard and, you know, I mean, the vest didn't really mind, even if I had a vest on anything, you know, you were concentrating that much, didn't realise that you were fit, prepared mentally and physically to go, so it didn't really matter. But what I was just nervous about was just like the different styles of it and the way, you know, people adapted to like, you know, 6-3 minutes and they were saying to me, you've got to slow down, Paul, you're doing 12 rounds now. Don't throw so many punches, you've got to slow down. I thought, well, if you train for 12 rounds, you're fit. You can throw as many punches as you want if you adapt to it. And I've always thought, no, I'm not slowing down that much, because that's the way of boxing, my style. Plenty of punches and, you know, plenty of attacking.
He just punch and punch and punch, and he's got the
Your first sort of real baptism, if you like, in the pros. You fought Neil Swain, in the Welsh guy, stopped him in the fourth, but it was a real battle, if I remember rightly. And you know, did you know that this program, you know, can be serious? Did Neil sort of, do you feel that in that fight?
Definitely, yeah. I mean, that woke me up. You know what I mean? I mean, it was comfortable until I fought Neil Swain, and I was getting comfortable with it, and saying it's going to adapt him well to this. You know what I mean? I come against Neil Swain, real nice kid, gentleman, you know what I mean, Neil? He's a real nice kid. And fought him and, whew, that did wake me up, you know what I mean? Caught me with a good few heavy shots. He's got something in them gloves, apart from his fists. But I mean, he, you know, it was like a good fighter, Neil. He caught me with a good shot. And, you know, but luckily I got for it to beat him.
15 fights unbeaten then, Paul. You went in with Colin McMillan. He was a seasoned pro at the time, 30-odd fights, it seems, in your 15th, and British title shot. Did it happen all sort of quick for you, that? You know, it was only like 2 years in as a pro, and you know, when you went in with McMillan.
Yeah, I mean, it did come quite quick, but there again, I thought they were progressing very well, and I thought my time was here now to take, you know, I'm a British champion, and just unfortunately it was Colin at the time, which he was a former world champion, and done everything and real nice kid, but I thought I've got the ability, you know, and the experience and the youth to beat him, which was a wicked fight, you know, can't, you know, take me off to Colin for going all on my rounds, because, you know, well, it was a good fight between us. I mean, he was saying, before press conference, which said, oh, I put it all up, oh, yeah, it'd be like taking the kid back to nursery this night. And I thought, you cheeky son, so, you know what I mean? I'll show you nursery. Fancy getting battered by a van then. But, you know, it was just nice to win it, you know, and he was just showing his experience, calling a slammering off a mouth, you know, saying, oh, yeah, I'm going to take you back to school, Paul. You're too young to be in this game. He's rushing everything. I thought, you're off to Walden, you're going to be retired tonight, you know what I mean? I didn't like that.
You know what you have to do? You have to get some stamina in the punches. You don't have to knock people out, but you have to get respect with your shot. And still Ingle all over him. The good quality, accurate punching from the champion in this round.
Good exciting fight, you all called left on green. Out of boxing, all the boxing people there, you know, that new boxing. It was just nice to beat him in his back garden.
Well, you don't often see a young challenger, comparatively inexperienced like Paul Ingle here, really going for the top chap, knowing he's got to take it away from the man almost in his own backyard. It's a good performance.
And all you could hear that night was just Scarborough people. It was like fighting down at sparring Scarborough, you know what I mean? All you could hear was Scarborough people. Couldn't even hear Collins people. Well, you couldn't after 2 rounds anyway. But I mean, he realised he had Collins, but it was just a brilliant fight to be in.
When Millen's cut like that, there's some problems. He's using the experience, he's trying to get a bit of space between him and Ingle. But once again, Ingle firing forward, getting close. Hey, Millen just can't keep him off, Reg.
No, he did. I'm surprised that he's not moving quicker. His legs are starting to be trying by the look of it there, McMillan. He should be pulling away from this in the fifth round. And then these punches are just battling into him and not really hurting him. They're hurting enough for me. I wouldn't want to take them.
Ingle has to be careful there that he doesn't blow himself out. McMillan's not in any great distress there.
No.
Okay, this will win you a round. Throwing so many punches, outwork an opponent, win a round. But sometimes it takes more out of you than it does the other guy. So he's going to have to think this fight could go long. At the moment, it doesn't look that way. But as I said, McMillan not in any signs of distress at the moment. He's covering up, now he's firing back.
Well, I could fight this one in a telephone booth. I don't need a big one. No. Yes, okay, he was letting the guy punch himself out there quite a bit. I was a bit surprised that he allowed it that long there, McMillan, but if that's his own tactic, well, if that's the way he fights, he might be right. Lindo Jimmy, that's coming from the head. What a battle. This is a tremendous battle. Full credit to McMillan. He's come back and shown the qualities of a champion. Yeah, I think he's put that gumshoe a little bit and saying, well, if I've got to do it the hard way, it's got to be done the hard way, McMillan.
See, he's sagging as well, just towards the end of the round. McMillan beginning to sag a little bit. Can he come back from this?
We certainly had some great ones at this weight, haven't we, over the years?
Well, there's sometimes in a championship fight, there's one round that decides who's going to take over, and this might be that round, because they've both had big rounds and used up a lot of steam. We'll have to see who can come back better. Look at young Ingle.
That's remarkable. He's almost like a sort of sawn-off Marciano there, isn't he?
Well, this could be the round that just tips the scales. McMillan's taking these shots, he's not slipping them, he's blocking some of them, but most of them are getting through. This little fella means business.
I'm amazed that he hasn't used the ring more. He usually does it for him, doesn't he?
He's tried that leg and it didn't work. This little fella wouldn't give him breathing space. He's tried everything he knows. He realises he's going to have to stand his ground and just do it the hard way. He doesn't like it, but full credit to him, he's doing it. This little fellow just won't stop. He's got the other eye cut. Look at the damage. Look at the state of McMillan's face. He is punched out of it.
He is.
Ingle is punching him out. Can he come back from this?
He really is. At first I thought maybe he's not play acting, but standing there trying to say, well, I'm not really hurt. But he's in trouble here, McMillan.
Greg, let's remember, this is a British title fight we're watching here. We've seen loads of world title fights. Couldn't hold a candle to this. It's great
absolutely
to see the British title being contested at this.
Absolutely.
This is a wonderful fight.
Oh yeah, this belongs in the Neil Charltons, Hal Winstons and Terry Spinks and believe in Barry McGregor.
McMillan coming back. Full credit to
what a round. I'll take you back about the previous round of the year. This could be it. And his right eye is bleeding quite badly here, McMillan.
Really is a mess, Reg. I don't know when the blood's wiped, maybe it won't look quite so bad. But he has shipped some punishment in this round. This is a tremendous round for the challenger.
This fellow's in a tremendous shape, Ingle.
There's still full power in these shots. McMillan looks as though he has nothing left. See, as I said earlier, this is not the way McMillan likes to do business. He's not a slugger, he's a classy boxer. And this real must look at the state of his face there. This must be in sheer pain.
He's never been through anything like this before. He won the World Championship going away, didn't he, against the Italian Stecco, Alexander Pope.
Yep, let Colin McMillan box his own fight, and he's one of the best in the business, but this is not what he does best. We reckon this was going to be a good fight at the edge, but we never dreamed it'd be like this.
I can't believe McMillan's leg could be played in at 30 years of age, really, and he hasn't been that active in recent times.
That leg, he's been forced to do what he doesn't like doing, and when you're the one, you can fight at a pace if you're the one exerting the pace, but it's always been Ingle who's been dictating the pace. He's been on top, he's been really controlling the action. McMillan's coming back wonderfully well, full credit, but this is not what he's good at.
Just trying to nick a breather there, wasn't he, Ingle? And McMillan spotted that, came back, and the crowd rose right away. But normal service resumes now. There it goes.
We'll find it hard to stop it on the floor, and quite rightly, the referee. This ring is going to be invaded like a carnival.
He's won titles and Lonsdale belt outright for me, man. I won the Lonsdale belt outright for him. My man wanted, always wanted the Lonsdale belt. And that was the proudest moment of my life, you know what I mean? Winning that Lonsdale belt for me, I'm definitely. And I won it for her. I brought it back home after beating Colin McMillan the next day, crying my eyes out, walking up path of it to give to my mum, which I'm proud to bits for, you know what I mean? Well, I always wanted to win the British title, but then they said I forgot about all that, and then, oh, this is a Lonsdale belt, but when this three times and you keep it. Oh yeah, nice one, yeah, I forgot about that. I don't know, I was thinking British title, and I, you know, thought, oh, nice one, so I've got to defend it another two more times, and it's mine. Then the only thing, Paul, they put it up to three now, you've got to defend it three times. Then you keep it, you know what I mean, what a nice one. So I mean, I boxed Billy Hardy in York to make it my title. And I booked Billy Hardy for I think it was for European. European, British and European, I think it was. And in York Hall, not York Hall, York Barbecue, but York. And Billy's a real nice kid, you know what I mean? Gentleman Billy. And I thought Billy, a brilliant experience fire, taught me a lot of stuff in that fire, you know what I mean? Woke me up. He had European in Billy, and I put my British up against him as well. Brilliant fight, we had a good, couple of press conferences build up to it. You know, saying what he's going to do to me and how experienced he is, and which I utterly respect Billy, he's a real nice gentleman, you know what I mean? And even to this today, he's a gentleman, he phones me up, comes to see me. There ain't many boxers that know what Billy Hardy's does, you know what I mean? Such a gentleman, good asset for the sport, you know what I mean? Real nice kid, Billy. Get on with him well now, phones him up and phones me up. He's a real nice kid he is, but as a boxer, excellent experience. Just unfortunate I had to beat him on the night to take the Commonwealth and European off him.
So, British Commonwealth European champion, the next step was obviously a world title shot, and it came in 1999 against probably one of the best British fighters, you know, we've produced, Prince Nasir Hamid. Take us back, Paul, you know, to that night, and you give Hamid his toughest fight to date. I think he said that, you know, obviously other than Barrera. You stopped in the last round, but, you know, if you would have got to the end, you know, it was close on the cards, you probably could have nicked it winning that last round.
Well, the referee said to me in the coming in the gym, I'm sorry, Paul, I had to stop in the fight. If you had put Hamid down or if you'd have gone the distance, you'd have been awarded the fight, you know what I mean? So, no, thanks a lot. But, I mean, he was just doing his job, the referee. I mean, it was a good fight between me and that. Real nice kid. I mean, got on with him real well. It was a really good fight. Just a shame we couldn't have got the rematch on after the last fight I got injured. Because that's what I was planning, you know what I mean?
It was a really lively build-up to it. And, you know, I think you really got under his skin as well, didn't you, in the build-up to the fight? And you had him worried.
Oh, definitely. I mean, a lot of people with good connections with Naz phoned me up and were telling me, you know, saying different stuff, do this, do that, or wind him up. And he was trying to wind me up, and it was just a good atmosphere. Oh, it went real quick training because the atmosphere was brilliant. It was going all the time. Everybody was talking about it. Two Yorkshire people, good fighters fighting for a British title. Doesn't happen that often, does it?
I know there was talk before, and they obviously did these long ring entrances and all that, and you said, if he takes more than 5 minutes, I'm going to get out, and you did. You got out and went back to the
dressing room. Well, I told him at a press conference, I said, if it takes me an hour to get there, lads, I'll take you an hour. I might be the challenger, but I'm there to do a job like you are. I said, come on, both men. I said, you know, if it takes me 10 minutes to get there, I'll give you 10 minutes to get there. If it takes me a minute, I'll give you a minute. But then we'll settle for 3 minutes. And I said, if you aren't here by 3 minutes, then I'm off back to the gym. I'll wait till you ring and I'll come when you're ready. So they went, hey, you won't do that, you won't do that, skyball, all that. I went, Naz, I'm here to do a job, and if you must go out, then I'll be out. He went, oh, we'll see. So, well, 3.5 minutes come and 4 minutes come, I said, right, Steve, six my word, I'm off now. He said, well, where? I said, I'm fucking up back to the gym. He said, I'm not waiting for him, that is it, you know, I've had enough. You can't, I said, you're on, mate. I said, I'm off. Come on. We'll wait for his ring and I'm off. So we go to our ring and he's looking, where's he going? He can't be going, he can't fight on. The fighting on. Oh no, the fighting's on, but I'll wait for that scare ring and I'll come back. I'm not fucking wasting time.
Jeff, perhaps the most interesting part of this lookout is that Ingle threatens to do it twice tonight if he's kept waiting too long for Hamid in the ring. But it looks like he's got some stuff going on for himself.
Trying to upstage Prince Nassim's anticipated, customary, overly elaborate entrance, while Ingle produces his own theatrics.
Well, he's called, calls himself the hunter, so I guess you just saw some machine gun bullets outline his attempt here to upstage the prince. I like it.
Oh, you're becoming a fan of these showy entrances, Larry?
I like showy entrances. I think that's something boxing can borrow from wrestling, as long as what goes on in the ring is honest.
The same amount of time to get into the ring, and if he doesn't get into the ring within the allotted time period established by the stopwatch, then Ingle will, as Larry mentioned, leave the ring, go back to the dressing room, and wait to come back out again after the prince has already made his entrance. We'll see if they'll follow through with that plan.
The prince called Ingle ugly in one of the fight promotion ads, and Maloney said the prince must not have any mirrors in his house.
Well, there it is. Ingle makes his entrance in a fatigue outfit befitting his paramilitary approach to training.
He calls himself in the Yorkshire Hunter.
Well, we could have some fun here tonight.
So Maloney apparently timing Hamed's entrance starting now. And that would seem to indicate that in a couple minutes, Maloney's going to turn to his fighter and say, let's get out of here, and they're going to leave the ring and go back to the dressing room.
His new image as being more modest than he used to be.
His entrance to the ring.
Down to just the defending an Aston Martin here and a horse there.
The Hamed entrance begins with triple princes.
Well, the prince likes to do a solo act. When he gets into the ring, he may have to do one.
This is the real prince entrance. Come out there, man.
Prince Hamed, I've heard, is getting a reported $7 million for this fight tonight. Most of it from overseas sources of television revenue. This is why he gets all that money. Whoa.
I can't wait to say that.
Maybe he has a new choreographer, as well as a new trainer, a new promoter, and a new manager.
All right, let's get to the music, man. Let's just stop dancing.
What do you think he's going to do when he gets to the ring and he turns out to be the only fighter there?
Maybe he'll leave. Go back to the dressing room. Ah, here comes Ingle.
So it was like 6-7 minutes by the time then. So I went back to the changing rooms and sat down for a couple of seconds, and they all come running in and went, come on, Paul, are you coming? I went, yeah, he's in the ring. Oh, is he back yet? Oh, is he ready to come in? Oh, come on, he's in the ring. So I thought, nice one. I've got him in the ring now. So coming all the way back to the ring and that, and he's then he's shaking his head. I thought, oh, nice one, I've got you. That's 1-0 to start with.
Prince has never been cut, he says, but he hired Gavin anyway. There's Ingle. And here comes Michael Buffer.
Lords, ladies and gentlemen, for the thousands in attendance and the millions watching around the world, ladies and gentlemen, to the Manchester Evening News Arena here in Manchester, England. 12 rounds of boxing for the WBO Featherweight Champion. championship over the world.
So I get in the ring, he's going, I'm going. And all his team's going, out of order. I said, no, I'm just being professional. I said, I'm sure he's doing a job where I need to like, keep the lights on. You know, and then all morning, I'm calling to go. Oh, they didn't like it. But I said to him, I'll give you one, as long as it takes me to get the ring. I said, you can come on fucking aeroplane if you want. As long as it only takes you, as long as it takes me. Fair enough. And no, you won't do anything. You want a bet, you watch. Oh, they didn't like it. But it worked anyway. So his little onshore backfired on them.
I mean, they certainly knew you meant business, didn't they, that night? And the fight shown that as well. You know, like you say, you pushed him all the way.
Yeah, I mean, I'll go with amateur fights and professional fights. I've never boxed anybody so awkward, you know what I mean? Genuine good boxer, very awkward fighter. All the internationals I've boxed for England, I've never boxed anybody as awkward as Naz. Take me out after him for that, because I mean, he was class act of what he did.
Rules meeting, the champion picks first. He picked a brand new pair of red gloves. They didn't have another pair of brand new red gloves left. So Paul Ingle got stuck with the yellow.
Don't blink. Ingle goes down on the left hand. Hadn't been knocked down in 5 years, only the second time in his career he's been knocked down. I guess the punching power remains intact.
The power is there. Now you look, Joe Cortez, when you see him in the ring, that means the champion is not worried about losing his crown. But this man has integrity. He should be crowned the referee, the best referee as far as integrity as we count.
Hard right hand by Hamed. Drives Ingle into the ropes. Prince Nassim has landed some power wallops in the first round. Two left hands and a right. And now Ingle lands a right hand coming back. As you know, Az has been down before plenty of times. He was down three times against Kevin Kelly in his first appearance on HBO. But as he says to us, hey, I always bounce back up. Round one ends. Nassim scored the knockdown against Ingle.
I just couldn't fault him the way he was fighting and what he did everything. Awkward style, awkward stance. The power we had was unbelievable. You never thought he had as much power. I mean, I know a lot of his shots were like lunging, and one proper boxing shot should have been one for his two shots, what he made. But it was an absolute electric fight. It was just awful. I got beat. Nightmare. But like I say, I mean, if I'd have gone for that last fight where I did get injured, the fight was on again for another Yorkshire showdown win.
He's better beware that Ingle has come here to win. Even though you knock him out, you can't play with him.
Ingle comes in close. Naz lands an uppercut. And you see the fluidity with which Prince Nassim is able to throw his combinations with power shots when you get in close.
You have to be careful. Ingle is using elbows a little here.
He beat me on the night and took me out of it. He beat me, that was it. If I had a return, then it would have been a different story again, but we never saw. He's still one little two, Naz.
Established himself in such a way that is the high expectations of him.
Did McCullough, though he won very few rounds, get a moral victory for going the distance against the Prince last Halloween?
Well, in a sense, he's earned a fight with Eric Morales, the wonderful junior featherweight champion in May. So that showing helped him.
Well, I broke his nose in the sixth round, and I thought I've got him, you know what I mean? Was a bit flat like, but that's boxing, you know what I mean? But I mean, so I got told, keep hitting my nose if he can pull. He hits getting it on nose. I said, well, I do as well, but he said, no, but he does, he loves his nose. I thought, all right, so I broke his nose in the sixth round, that helps. But obviously, it was just a good fight. I mean, overall, the fight, the atmosphere around being generated brilliant for boxing. It was a good atmosphere for everybody, you know what I mean?
What tells the story, we'll see after the night with the ratings. How many seats were about to...
Well, I think it sort of depends on how you sell it. You never went out of your way, as the Prince does, to style yourself a knockout artist and say you were going to dominate your opponent. The body shot hit it again. Second vicious left-hand body shot of the evening for Nassim.
You can't catch his wind. That's a hard shot to recover from.
Only 10 seconds left in the round. Let's see if Naz launches a wild. Went back to the body. With both hands to the body. And really hurts Ingle as the sixth round comes to a close.
That's what they came to see, George.
That's right.
Just a shame it couldn't have happened again, but it could still happen, couldn't it, Naz, behind closed doors? Joking.
And he's very effective at it.
He's now back in the southpaw stance, so left hands here are crosses. Either way, they're effective. And while he does generate power with the right hand, the more we watch him, the more it seems that the left is his thunder and lightning. Get ready for this fight.
Ingle caught the Prince napping a little bit. That's what happens when your corner tells you to get in there and go straight punches, get a little closer. You start thinking about all of this foolishness and you find yourself waiting for something. Prince hit yourself. What had happened in the floor thing?
Prince Nassim produced 2 8th-round knockouts in his career. He knocked out both Steve Robinson and Tom Boom Johnson in round 8.
Oh, I didn't go many rounds.
Ingle's the kind of kid who would start a fight in an empty room. He really wants to try to do it. But it's very hard to do what you'd like to do against a fighter of Nassim's style, power, and quickness.
Yeah, he really wants to fight.
Good right hand by him. Naz slowing down a little bit in this round.
The corners over there has confused this guy an awful lot.
You mean the Prince?
Yeah, he's been awfully confused tonight, standing around trying to do what they told him to do.
There are a lot of Yorkshiremen in the crowd rooting for Paul Ingle, rooting against Prince Nassim, and Ingle's having his moments again in round number 10. Crowd thought Nassim almost went down. He was off balance, as is so frequently the case, and Ingle is landing his right-hand shots fairly freely now. He comes back in the latter stages of the fight.
Prince has never been in this kind of a war. Not over a distance. Of course, his fight with Kelly was a short, intense war.
He's got one solid fighter in front of him, that Brian Ingle.
It'll be ruled a slip. And round 10 comes to a close. For showmanship effect, Nassim flips up, or kips up, I should say, from the mat.
He stopped you in the 11th round. You're looking back on it, what went wrong for you in the, you know, in the late stages of the fight? Because you obviously was doing great before then.
Just, I mean, the work rate that I'd put in and the punches that I'd give him and the punches that he'd give me. Obviously, it took his toll. I mean, he caught him in the 11th, can't take it away from him.
23-9 edge and power shots. So the momentum of the bout belongs to the underdog, Paul Ingle, as we go into the championship rounds, 11 and 12.
And it looks as though the Prince has decided to freeze the ball.
Nassim's insurance. He has scored 2 knockdowns in the bout against Ingle.
He's the better boxer, so he should win this fight. And if a knockout presents itself, let it happen.
Here's the third knockdown. And Pollard told Ingle it would be dangerous. And Joe Cortez stops it.
Good shot, the ref. You've both had enough punches. I think Sam's all the fight now, which was fair enough. I mean, if it had carried on, then I'd have beat him. That was the fact, what the referee said. They had you going into that 11th round just in front, and he was out on his feet now, do you know what I mean? I just never seen Naz change colour and like open his mouth so much, looking for air. every second of the fight, every excuse that I did, he was moaning all the time. And I thought, just catch you once you're gone. But it never happened, and you can always say, you know, it was a good fight, that was it, he beat me fair enough.
Parsley, sage, rosemary, and thyme. Remember me to one who lives there. She once was such a love of mine. Tell her to make me a camera. Parsley, sage, rosemary, and thyme. Without no seed.